once you have tasted flight, you will walk the earth with your eyes turned skywards, for there you have been, and there you will long to return. I spent 6 years working towards this goal, and now I'm a fully qualified pilot flying passengers around Europe for one of the most prestigious airlines in the world. In the next 10 minutes, I'm going to show you how I achieved my goal, and then pass on some useful advice and information on how to become a pilot. Keep the dream alive. The Royal Air Force first introduced me to flying when I was in the Air Cadets at school. After leaving school with A-levels, I went on to university to study a degree in engineering. At university, I was fortunate enough to be selected to join the Royal Air Force University Air Squadron, where between lectures I was being taught to fly, and at just aged 18, I was flying solo. My time at university was an amazing experience, and many of my classmates went on to join the Royal Air Force, Royal Navy, and Army for careers as military pilots. After graduating from university, I decided to pursue a career in the commercial aviation industry by taking the plunge and joining a flight school with the aim of achieving my commercial pilot's license. Kidlington, Oxford. The flight school where I enrolled on the integrated flight training course in 2006. I joined course AP264 with 23 other students. The course takes 1.5 years to complete, leading to professional qualification to join an airline as a first officer or co-pilot. The first 6 months we studied the ATPL theoretical ground school course, after which we had to sit 14 exams on subjects such as principles of flight, meteorology and air law. After we completed the ground school phase, we travelled out to the Oxford Fairweather Flying Base in Phoenix, Arizona, in the United States. We spent 4 months there learning how to fly the single-engine Piper Warrior aircraft. Students have to pass a flight test after about 40 hours, which is the equivalent to a private pilot's license. As the course progresses, students learn advanced flying skills such as night flying and instrument flying. We then moved on to the twin-engine Piper Seneca aircraft to complete our multi-engine flying training, after which we take the commercial pilot's license flight test and leading to the award of our pilot's wings. We then returned to the UK to complete the last few months of training for the instrument rating. The instrument rating flight test is probably the most challenging flight test a pilot will have to undergo in their career. Finally, we move on to the jet simulator, where we learn the basic handling skills to fly a passenger jet aircraft and teaches teamworking and multi-crew skills essential for the safe operation of an airliner. And that's it. The course is finished and we were all in a position to apply to airlines for the position as a first officer. Our course was very successful in securing employment with airlines, and other videos on our AP264 YouTube channel detail that success. I was fortunate enough to be recruited by British Airways. They sponsored me through a type rating course, after which I was fully qualified to fly the Boeing 737 aircraft at the age of just 22. Now you've seen my journey to become a pilot, it's important to point out that my route is just one of many that you can follow. Pilots come from many different backgrounds, and there is no one right or wrong way regarding which path you follow. Likewise, the advice I'm about to give is merely that of my own opinion, and does not reflect those of British Airways. If you ask me how to become a pilot, I would say you need just 6 things. It's a fairly simple formula. All you have to do is to complete these 6 requirements. Firstly, you have to have the right desire or motivation to want to become a pilot. The training courses and exams require dedication and ultimately lots of hard work to complete. Flying needs to be something that you aspire to, something you enjoy. For those of you who have never been flying, I strongly suggest booking a trial flight at your nearest flying school. You need to experience flying and discover if it's really for you. A trial flying lesson usually costs about £50. I would also strongly recommend you take flying lessons and get yourself to a solo standard. This generally would take about 15 hours to achieve and would cost in the region of £2,000. There are scholarships available through the Air League, GAPAN and Air Cadets, which will pay for you to get to a solo standard for free. Understandably, places for scholarships are extremely competitive. Ability. This is your ability to actually pilot an aircraft and work as part of a team. I'll subdivide this into 3 parts. Firstly, your aptitude, which is a measurement of your raw piloting ability. Computerized tests are used to measure different abilities such as hand-eye coordination, multitasking or cognitive skills. I would highly recommend having your aptitude independently measured before you set off on becoming a pilot. Whilst the tests are not 100% accurate, they are a good indicator of your potential success with training. The Guild of Air Pilots and Air Navigators, or GAPAN as they are more commonly known, can arrange these tests for you. Find these details on their website. You can try an aptitude test online now on the EPST website. The test can be accessed following these links. It is free to use, so it is certainly worth a go. Education. To be a pilot, you need as a minimum GCSEs or equivalent qualification in English, Maths and Science. I would strongly recommend staying on at school to complete A-levels. If you are choosing A-level subjects, pick the ones you enjoy and can therefore do well at and get top grades. Having said that, it's certainly beneficial to have A-levels in maths and physics, although not a requirement. University-level education is not necessary, however, a university degree could provide a sufficient backup plan should you not be successful in becoming a pilot. Personality is very important. You need to have the suitable character traits which airlines are looking for. For example, you need to be responsible, calm under pressure, maintain high standards, be a good communicator, and lead by example. But above all, you have to be able to get on with people. Put simply, in an interview situation, an assessor will be thinking to themselves, could they happily sit next to this person for 8 hours, confined to a small space at the front of an airliner? You need to meet the Civil Aviation Authority Class 1 medical requirements. Details can be found on the CAA website. The initial exam to get certified costs around £500 and must be renewed each year for a cost of approximately £150. One of the most frequent questions I get asked is, I wear glasses, can I become a pilot? The answer is you need to get your eyes tested to see if they conform to the CAA requirements. Have a look at this link. You need to get financing to pay for your flight training. The majority of students will self-sponsor, i.e. pay for themselves using bank loans and savings. Now some airlines and organisations offer sponsorship. In 2008, Etihad offered full sponsorship to candidates of any nationality, i.e. all training was free and successful candidates were placed with the airline for 5 years. Other airlines offer part sponsorships like Flybe, who offer cadets about £20,000 to cover the costs of training and an offer of employment. GAPAN offer the JN Summer Scholarship, which will pay for a full flight training course. See their websites. At the moment, there are two types of license you can get. The Multi-Pilot's License, MPL, which is relatively new and requires part sponsorship with an airline. However, the most common route is to get a frozen ATPL, which is a term used for a person who holds a commercial pilot's license, instrument rating, and multi-crew certificate. There are two types of flight training course available, integrated or modular, which offer this license. Afterwards, you will need a type rating qualification to bridge the gap between a frozen ATPL and actual airline employment as a first officer. Once you have achieved 1,500 hours of flying experience at an airline, your frozen ATPL will be what's called unfrozen, and you will hold a full airline transport pilot's license, which is the required qualification to become a captain. Now, out of my 6 requirements that I've listed, number 6, recruitment, is the only variable in the equation. A quick history lesson. This is the British Airways share price over the past 20 years. It shows extremely well the cycles of contraction and growth which the global aviation industry is subject to. World events such as the Gulf War, 9/11 terrorist attacks, SARS, and more recently the global economic recession, severely impact the profit-making abilities of airlines as passengers fly less. Airlines make huge losses during these periods of contraction. They have to fly less to stop losing money. This requires less aircraft and therefore less pilots. So airlines are not recruiting and often making pilots redundant, which means there is an overall surplus of pilots. During the good times, when the airline is in profit, it is usually expanding, buying more aircraft, which means they need more pilots to crew them. Coupled with the numbers of retiring pilots, airlines often find they have a huge shortage of pilots during these periods and therefore start recruiting. So what you need to do is ensure that you've completed your training and looking for employment during one of these periods of recruitment. Whilst this year, in 2010, we're in a period of pilot surplus, there are many positive factors which are pointing to a sustained growth throughout the next decade. Airlines have huge orders for new aircraft, coupled with an aging workforce, will require something like 40,000 new pilots in Europe. But any new world event like 9/11 could put a stop to that. A double-dip recession next year or the eruption of the Icelandic volcano could hamper airline growth in the next decade. Some people call it timing or luck, and it is perhaps an element of both. Put simply, you have to be in the right place at the right time to get recruited. I would highly recommend the So You Want to Be a Pilot publication, which is updated and republished every few years. You can download for free a copy off the GAPAN website using the link shown below. You should also visit careersinaerospace.com, a website that I help create that has lots of great impartial advice about piloting careers. And you can put your questions to an expert panel of pilots in the online forum. It also has lots of great careers advice about CVs, interviews, and making job applications. Also, twice a year, Flyer organises a flight training exhibition in London and Dublin. It is definitely a must to go to these events, as airlines and flight schools will be there to offer information and advice. Watch these videos of frequently asked questions.